And we were, every time I'd come up for air, there was over 1,000 people on the bank. And they were screaming orders to us. I learned lots of lessons in all of this stuff through the years. Don't tell me where to go unless you're going to get in the water with me. That's another thing you don't do to guys like me. You're going to get in that water with me, and you're going to suffer, and you're going to understand, and you're going to let it beat on you. I'll listen to you. But you're going to stay on the bank, and you're going to know everything, and we don't know nothing, but the little bit we know, we're trying, and you're not. Shut up.
I went to church last night. Dennis Kramer was at our local church, and I got a wonderful, wonderful, timely, prophetic word spoken over me. After he's done with my word, he said something that I'm going to play in this video. So the synchronicity of it all is perfect. The Holy Spirit is perfect in the way he works. During the church service, during worship, the Holy Spirit dropped in my spirit that I need to do another video directly confronting Molech again. I also heard from Dennis Kramer that in his ministry, one of the most common ailments that he deals with is healing barrenness, which is also a direct confirmation of the spirit of Molech. But before I attack this, and I'm not doing territorial warfare, I am confronting Molech in the children of God. But before I do this and expect a new wave of attack, I need to cinch up some holes in my armor that the Holy Spirit has let me know about. And that is being susceptible to the accuser of the brethren. You don't know me, and you know I'm pretty aggressive on these videos, and I think that's the Holy Spirit. If I act out of my flesh, I apologize. That is not the Holy Spirit. But being aggressive towards the enemy and towards the enemy's lies and towards the milquetoast church traditions, I believe that is the Holy Spirit to be aggressive towards. But based on my own upbringing, I haven't had too much support in my life, and so I have carried the world on my own shoulders. Jesus Christ rebuked me personally, saying that I believe and have faith that Jesus will heal the hearts of those who I'm working with, but Jesus rebuked me and said, "But you don't have faith that I can heal your heart." And so that is something that I'm continuing to be healed of, father issues, abandonment. It's been kind of a lonely road. Needless to say, I have my own issues. And so I look at other people's videos and they just get trounced with accusations and condemnation and mockery and torment and all that stuff. And to be quite honest, like the Lord has protected me from a lot of that, from a lot. But still yet, the stuff that I do get, the emails, the comments that I do get hurt. And to be in this ministry, Jesus Christ has given me a sensitive, empathetic spirit, and that is required. People are telling me their deepest, darkest secrets, and I'm still able to empathize and feel Jesus Christ's love and compassion. And no matter, and I need to speak to this lie too, no matter what people have done, incest, bestiality, murder, child sacrifice, it doesn't matter. There's not one person that I have ever met. I have always felt Jesus Christ's compassion and love and acceptance and willingness to heal them because they are repenting, because they are humbling themselves, and because they are seeking his face. If the enemy says that you've gone too far, that is a lie from the pit of hell. Okay, so I just need to speak against that lie. So it is good that I have a empathetic, sensitive spirit. But on the same token, I am also sensitive to the attacks of the enemy, and I take it personally. And that is a weakness of mine that I'm trying to cinch up right now. And so in doing so, I confess in front of you and in front of God that I have critiqued and criticized other men and women of God while I was sitting on my butt, while I was not doing anything for the body of Christ. I was critiquing them and wiping my mouth and saying, "Give me more," but yet not applying it, not being a good Berean. And so I want to read that to you. Acts 17, verse 10. And the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews. These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and searched the scriptures daily, whether those things were so. So again, they were more noble because they received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the scriptures. They weren't hard-hearted. They actually searched the scriptures to see what the Holy Spirit was telling them, and if it was true, and if it was, then they applied it. Verse 12, therefore many of them believed, also of honorable women which were Greeks, and of men, not a few. Now, look at this verse. But when the Jews of Thessalonica had knowledge that the word of God was preached of Paul at Berea, they came thither also and stirred up the people. So that word stirred up means to incite, to riot, to agitate, to get you off of your peaceful mind. So here is an example that wherever God goes, there is a demonic element that follows to stir up and uproot the fruits that the Lord is trying to lay down. We also see that in the parable of the seed. Some seed lands on hard ground, and Satan is right there as birds to come and pick that word up before it's able to take root. Acts 6:12, and they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes and came upon him and caught him and brought him to the council. Acts 13:50, but the Jews stirred up the devout and honorable women and the chief men of the city and raised persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them out of their coast. Acts 14:2, but the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and made their minds evil, affected against the brethren. I'm a major believer in what you sow is what you reap. So me being sensitive to the accuser of the brethren, I confess as sin in my past that I have criticized and come against brothers and sisters who are doing the best they can to save the lost, to heal the sick, to preach the good news. And while I sat on my butt, I criticized them. So I repent and I confess that as sin before you and the Father. And now I renounce in the name of Jesus Christ, the accuser of the brethren and all of his tools and minions. The Bible says in Matthew 11, verse 16, but whereunto shall I liken this generation? It is like unto children sitting in the markets and calling unto their fellows, and saying, we have piped unto you, and ye have not danced. We have mourned unto you, and ye have not lamented. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he hath a devil. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, behold, a man gluttonous and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of her children. No matter how the Holy Spirit has come and tried to come at you and show you the truth, you're not interested. No matter what tactic the Holy Spirit has used in your life, you are hard-hearted. So I ask you to be Bereans, please. Do not be used by the enemy. If you're accusing the brethren, then you're a tool of the enemy. For deliverance, for example, the little faith that I have, the one loaf of bread that I do have, and the Lord through me is we're seeing some good results, some miraculous results. Now you can sit on the sidelines and point at me and say, well, you don't have a bread factory like the Bible says you should. Because yes, Jesus Christ said, go. And the demons, thousands of them left. Okay, it wasn't a comprehensive questionnaire and all the stuff that the Holy Spirit has led me to do right now. I believe that will come. That is my long-term goal, is to have that faith. But based on the little I have, I am working towards that goal. Now, you need to take an inventory, and instead of pointing at me and saying, or other brothers and sisters, but you don't have a bread factory, so you're in error. But let's take a self-assessment, can you, please? Have you baked any bread in years? It sounds like you just criticize bread recipes. You sit on the sidelines and say, oh, I wouldn't use that flour. And I would use the honey that flows from the promised land. You know, you can criticize and you can say what you would do on how you would bake the bread. But in all actuality, when's the last time you did bake bread? and give it to somebody else. So yes, I admit freely, 100%, I do not have a bread factory, but I do have loaves that God has given me. And I am giving that away because if I give my one loaf away, God will give me two loaves. And I'm going to give those away. And God's going to give me three loaves. I'm going to give those away. Okay? That's how it works. That's how it works. My end result is to have the bread factory. My end result is to say the word in Jesus Christ's name and through his power and his authority and see people be delivered within seconds. And it's coming. We're seeing great fruit. So by confessing my criticism of the brethren, I'm taking away legal right for the accuser of the brethren because I think I'm reaping what I sowed, so I renounce that in the name of Jesus Christ. I will not accept accusations. And if I do, I believe Jesus Christ now will heal me and protect me from that. I'm not going to protect myself. If I do put out a video, I 100% believe it's from the Holy Spirit. And so right now, I've said my piece, and here's two more brothers in the faith that have more reputation in the body of Christ than I do. God bless you. I love you.
Hallelujah. This is known as equipping the saints for their work of what? Ministry. I'd like to tell you there's a gift of spectating in the Bible, but I can't find it. A bunch of you think you have the gift of spectating. Come on, you go to church and what do? Essentially, you spectate. I can't find that gift in the Bible. In the Bible, I read about an active laity. A mobile laity. That would be you. An active laity. A mobile laity. Every man and every woman had something to do in Christ. It's called a call. Come on. We used to sing a song years ago. It is the time to take the kingdom. Rise up, be strong. Possess the land. For every power, might, and dominion is given now into our hands. He that has ears to hear the trumpet, he that has heart to understand, it is the time to take the kingdom. Rise up, be strong, and possess the land. Amen?
Amen.
That's a good mandate right there. Listen to me. What have you done for God lately? 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 What's God done for me? Wrong question. What have you done for God lately?
Monsoons came. It was my first year to mess with monsoons. I didn't understand monsoons very well. I got a good understanding now. And so the tap on my gate, I go out there to find one of those young men there, Mr. David, because I'm a pretty good athlete and I'm an excellent swimmer. So he said, look, you need to get your flippers. And one of the fellas that was in our little group fell in the river. The monsoon river, they swell up pretty fast and they're real treacherous and very bad. And he was in there. He's been in there an hour now. Would you please come help? So I grab my flippers, run down to the edge of the river, and I strip down and jump in there, put my flippers on, dove right in. Poof, muddy, murky, scary water. It's called a remolino. It was flowing backwards from the current of the river, and it was a big, what is a remolino? Whirlpool. There was four of us in the water, and we were looking, they were sure that boy was down in there somewhere. And we were, every time I'd come up for air, there was over 1,000 people on the bank. And they were screaming orders to us. I learned lots of lessons in all of this stuff through the years. Don't tell me where to go unless you're going to get in the water with me. That's another thing you don't do to guys like me. You're going to get in that water with me, and you're going to suffer, and you're going to understand, and you're going to let it beat on you. I'll listen to you. But you're going to stay on the bank, and you're going to know everything, and we don't know nothing, but the little bit we know, we're trying, and you're not. Shut up. I mean that in a good sort of way. So we're in there, and sure enough, it tangled up in those willows. Y'all know what willow trees are? It's a tree that it got big old long skinny limbs, and when it's covered in water, there are tentacles. You go by, it just wraps you up and won't let you go, and it's scary, especially when it's black under there. That thing grabbed hold of me, and I was able to, thank you, Jesus, break all those limbs and get away. Marked me up a little bit. That's okay. Because all of a sudden, reaching out and trying to get away, I touched the body. Broke him loose, brought him up. Okay. Little boat, put him up in the boat. And us fellows, we got him in there, and we was talking about what to do with him. And so we decided to go ahead and just take him on out, and so we did. And all these people are on the bank trying to tell us all these things. Now, we got him out, laid him on the thing, and right in the middle of all that mass confusion, the mother was screaming and the daddy was wailing and the family, and it was rough. It was rough. I don't like being around it, but you have to sometimes. So we laid that boy down there. Right in the middle of all of that, Jesus spoke to me to pray for him. I will raise him from the dead. You're right. It was an awesome moment. But I disobeyed. Oops. How did it go? Uh-oh. And I'm standing there and I'm watching all of this confusion and all this hurt and pain. Do you understand what at that moment I am for the kingdom of God? I am a doorway of power. But because of what I'm looking at right here, faces of men, fear gripped me at the same time that faith did. Doubt and unbelief. My king was asking for fruit. And let me show you what I did. I was bent over him like this. I walked off. Oh, that's a bad feeling. I wouldn't suggest you doing that either. It don't go very well with you in a few minutes. I can still feel the hurt and the emotions of the moment because I disobeyed God Almighty. Listen to this. I live with this every day, okay? I condemned that 14-year-old boy to eternal damnation. He was not born again. Uh-oh. By the time I made it home, the demon that was riding my back had made his job pretty complete. I was useless. I began to blubber and to go into confusion and doubt, and condemnation was huge, and all sorts of other demons and deception had settled in, and the cloud that I could not see through and could not sort out the emotions of, and had gotten a hold of my spirit and had... because I had submitted to it. Because of one thing, the fear of man. You can take your intimidation and go back to hell you came out of with it. Not anymore for me. No, sir. No, sir. I won't eat that no more. It's a bad and sour pill. It's not for me. That's why I seem aggressive to you. That's why I seem like, my God, this fella is overpowering. He's intimidating. I won't allow certain things that have eaten my lunch in the past to even get at the table. You're not even allowed to sit up with me. You can go to hell. Right now is fine. Yahoo! And I mean it. Oh, I can feel aggression on me. Well, can you feel it? No. Woo! Man. And so what happened was I went through about a month of the most miserable days of my life. And finally, thanks be to God for a good woman. My wife is real tiny, but she's really feisty. She's a good lady. She comes marching in there. She grabbed me by the collar. And she said, "Now then, listen to me. I didn't want to. I was rolling in the mire of it. I didn't want to hear her. I didn't want to hear anybody." She said, "This is what you're going to do." This was not a choice. I wasn't the king anymore. She said, "You will either get out there and win souls like Jesus told you to do, and you will let the devil fall off of you, and you will forgive yourself, and you will let God forgive you, or let's go home." That was God talking to me. And she was the only one with the guts enough to tell me. And I looked at her and I said, "Okay." So I got up and got a few tracks and I went out there and fired up that old 454 positive traction, 456 gears, tuned headers, tuned carburetors, fired up that big old four-wheel drive and went out into a village and come back, and I was a little bit better. And the next day, she helped me to get in the truck again, and I was a little bit better until finally, after a while, probably another month, I was running it full steam again. But now I have the most valuable lesson of all under my belt. I am a failure without obedience to the name of Jesus. Yahoo! That makes me powerful because I know what the bowels of failure and hell are all about. Total destruction for the human body and soul. Total annihilation of what little ministry there is. You must realize Jesus is your source. Jesus is your mainstay. Without Him, you're nothing, but with Him, you can do anything.